Hi, everybody. You're all very welcome to Science Gallery this evening for our talk, Future Money and the Design of Security. This talk is taking place as part of our events programme for Secret, which is our current exhibition running until the 1st of November. It'll be open until 8 o'clock tonight. If anybody hasn't a chance to look around, please do. Without further ado, I'll hand you over to our host for this evening, who is Emma Kennedy, who is the money editor of the Sunday Business Post. Thanks a million.
Welcome everyone to tonight's event, as Emma said. I suppose by way of context, I've been writing about money for the last 10 years at the Sunday Business Post, and in that time, how we use and how we interact money has changed hugely. If you think back to 10 years ago, we didn't have online banking or mobile banking in the way we use it today. We probably all went to the bank a lot more, went to the branch a lot more, dealt in cash a lot more. Contactless payments were something that we hadn't even thought of yet. Mobile wallets, Apple Pay, all these kind of concepts weren't even on our radar at that stage. Even the way we move forward with money is going to change again. We've evolved so far to here and we've a lot more evolution to go. For example, if you look at last week's budget, the Minister for Finance announced that he's trying to encourage us all to use cash a little less and electronic payments a little more with a charge levied on ATM withdrawals. Just tonight, we're going to take a look, a whistle-stop tour through the history of money, the future of money, and everything in between. We're going to look at design. We're going to look at security features. We're going to look at how we use money and how we like to trace our usage of it and the anonymity that goes with cash and how do we maintain that with other types of transactions and the security features of other transactions. So maybe just to start us off, to put us all in the right frame of mind, have a think about the transactions you did today. Did you go onto your mobile phone, pay a bill or do anything else? Did you use Halo or any other apps? Did you tap and go on your card to make a payment under 15 quid or now under 30 since the budget? Do you think when you make those transactions, do you think about convenience? Do you think about security? Just to get us in the frame of mind, have a little think about your own relationship with money. Tonight we've got three really interesting speakers for you. First up is Scott Burnett, who's a designer and he's the co-founder of AAD, an agency. He's going to be taking us on a whistle-stop tour of the history of money. He's going to be looking at how it's designed, how it's made, what value it's had over history, what value it has for us now, and how we think about the design of it. Next up is Paul Molumby, who's the director of currency at the Central Bank. Paul's going to be giving us a behind-the-scenes tour of the Mint, for those of you who've driven past it out in Dundrum. He's going to be talking about how we make money, how it features in circulation, the security features built into it. And just as a taster, you might see these blocks down the front here. Each of these blocks, according to Paul, is worth about 26 grand. That's 26 grand, yep. These are destroyed money, money that's disappeared out of circulation. It didn't meet the standards, or it's got a stain, or some other reason that it's taken out of circulation. The central bank then shred it and block it up like this, and apparently it's very good bedding for hamsters. So if you have a hamster out there that wants to roll in cash, here's its chance. Finishing up then tonight, we have Dr. Rachel O'Dwyer, who's a specialist in computer science and statistics and a fellow here in Trinity College. She's going to talk to us through the more modern aspects of money, virtual currencies, cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin, and all the other things that I probably can't claim to understand. She's going to talk about the security features of those things and also about how we like to remain anonymous and whether to pose a question on whether we have a right to remain anonymous in the transactions that we carry out. We'll finish up then when the three guys have made their presentation with a panel discussion, just looking at some of the things we've talked about tonight. And then finally, we'll close up by opening to your questions. So as everyone's chatting, make note of those questions and hit us with a few at the end. So without further ado, I'll call up Scott to kick things off.
Thanks, Emma. Is this thing on? Okay, my name's Scott Burnett. I'm a designer and a creative director of my own agency called AAD in Dublin. We work in kind of branding and that sort of stuff. And I guess I was probably asked along to talk about kind of the aesthetics of money. But really the thing that interests me is, I'm interested in how things look, but I'm interested in the kind of factors, the underlying factors that kind of come together to make things look a certain way or how things kind of work. So, you know, this talk is about the future of money. And really what I wanted to take a look at was the conceptual evolution of money. You know, the best way to speculate about the future of something is to look at its past. And, even from a personal point of view, I wanted to kind of take a kind of look through how it evolved, so I get a better sense of, you know, what's the context for the future of it. You know, in the beginning, there was barter. You know, it, as with most things, it begins with pure functionality. I have a cow. I'd like some of your grain. Let's swap. Soon after, we get a lure. People like shiny things. Desire is never too far behind functionality. And this was in kind of, there we go. And then they started, there was a kind of development into the control of availability, so preciousness. So using precious metals to make things that they could then swap. So these are Chinese copper money knives, as they were called. I like the idea of money knives. It seems to suit it. This is being quite slow. I apologize about this. And ultimately, you know, barter was about equivalency. So these are shekels or shekel weights. You've probably all heard of shekels. Shekels actually eventually became a kind of a type of money. But originally, a shekel was actually a measure of weight. And it was a specific weight of barley. So it was a single unit that defined both mass and currency. And that really kind of like sums up the period of barter. You know, it was about kind of like, this is worth the same as this, and I have this, and you have that, this, and we're going to swap it. Then as we kind of moved into coins, what coins had was that metal-based coins had the advantage of carrying their value within the coins themselves. But ultimately, there was a whole new kind of language that had to evolve because, you know, it brought the need to make people believe in this thing that you were handing me and said it was of value. I needed to know that it was important, so figureheads started appearing on there. You know, this is kind of coming from the top down. This person has kind of sanctioned this and said it's okay. Opportunities for identity, you know, it's the start of kind of like a sense of national identity. Myths and legends started kind of appearing on coins. Opportunities to use stories to create a relationship to the thing that you are, I'm now skipping past it. Opportunities and to create relationships by linking it to local and national identity. And then ultimately, this was all about portability. So these coins could be carried around. This is a Chinese coin, and they all had kind of square holes in the middle, so they could be linked onto pieces of string and carried around for kind of ease of use. And ultimately, that's what kind of the coin system was about. I already said that, so that's grand. And ultimately, then this evolved into kind of consistency. Denominations were introduced, so actually different weights of different metals were kind of produced, and it was easier for people to kind of sort out what was 50p and what was a euro and all that kind of stuff, whatever they were called back in the time. And then it evolves into paper money, which is a kind of massive leap of imagination, really. And how this kind of evolves is, a lot of traders are carrying all that heavy metal around, and it was annoying, cumbersome, and dangerous in case they got kind of hopped by some bandits who were looking to take their little chain of coins. So someone had the bright idea to issue receipts that held the promise of value. Actually, I think I've skipped past one yet. So this is a giant conceptual leap, really. You know, it required a new set of concepts to make it believable, and it also offered new opportunities to draw people in and create relationships with this thing. So you can start to see it. This is the earliest ever banknote, and it's got a story going on in it. You know, it's like a much more, before it was kind of like symbols and it was very iconic, and here is the coin. Banknotes were a much bigger canvas, and they actually allowed people to kind of like tell stories of how important this was and things that happened, and isn't this great, and don't we all want to be part of it? It also allowed for a much wider range of trading, so circulation became greater. You know, coins tended to be within a kind of a geographical area where it was like, you know, within a particular nation. This kind of suddenly became, you know, wider circulation, but of course it needed a whole new set of security features. I read that some of the Chinese writing on that says counterfeiters will be put to death. You know, that obviously worked. Okay, I'll be put to death. I will not make another one of these with my trusty skills as a printer. And also authorization. So it was no longer enough to be authoritative and kind of say that this comes from a head of state. As paper money evolved, it had to be clear that permission had been granted and that this was an official document. This in some ways is kind of encapsulates the whole thing about paper money. A lot of industry is now put in to maintain what was this huge suspension of belief. And it's all held within one heroic phrase, promise to pay the bearer. And it's this idea, and to this day, most money still says this, and it's this idea that I can rock up to a bank and demand the equivalent amount of something in actual, you know, I would like €5 worth of gold, please, bank teller. That's what that statement means. And this kind of idea that this piece of paper, I mean, it's kind of like it doesn't hold the value of what it says it is. And this is something that took a while to gain ground in the next slide that will come up. In 1730, the Bank of England, who were kind of, at that stage, they'd kind of had denominations of paper money and it was widely circulated. And there was a kind of run on the bank because customers, there was some crisis that happened and customers were suddenly like, I want my equivalents of gold. Here's all my paper money, give me my gold. And it almost caused the bank to fail. This wasn't, this kind of idea that this paper is worth something was something that took a long time to establish itself in the minds of people. And I think that's really an important thing. As money became more representative, it's not about actually what it's worth. It's about saying that, you know, this is worth something and it's not. So it's representative. Everything was done to make it hard to copy, but also to convince us of its value. Back to where it was, ornamentation. So things like filigree, ornamentation, cotton papers, untearable papers, holograms, embossing, incredible inks. These things are a security feature, but as far as I'm concerned, they're also very much there to convince you that this is something really important, really valuable. The language of it is all about that sense of craft and something important. And it was also, it became the most powerful propaganda tool ever invented. If the message failed to convert, then the value would, you know? The United States is a perfect example of which was the last one, and now we're skipping ahead again. Sorry about this. Oh, all the way forwards. Do it like the remote control at home. So proclamation, this was very much a propaganda tool. This was about nation making. This was about how important it is. You know, it's like the everything in this banknote is puffy and over the top and self-important. You know, and if you didn't buy the message, then here's 300 of them, and who's the boss now? Proclamation. Interpretation. So monetary value started to align with cultural values. It became a canvas for artists and designers, a way to underline a nation's sophistication. So in certain parts, the figureheads are being replaced with engineers, scholars, artists, so really kind of starting to kind of, you know, it's about more than just this authority thing. Paper money is starting to evolve into something that is much more about how we see ourselves culturally. And then we have the credit card. So as people traveled and traded in wider circles, a need for something even more flexible developed. You know, it's this idea that, you know, there's a much wider, again, kind of circulation is much wider. And, it, you know, I don't want to be carrying all this cash in me if I have to go to a different country. I want to be able to kind of bring something and say, you know, I have this money. So money could be sent originally via telegram, stretching that promise to pay the bearer to a promise to believe the sender. You know, so suddenly the sender was a kind of important part in this whole transaction. Whereas paper money had kind of maybe been about the kind of like figurehead and the kind of establishment. And suddenly there was a whole new set of, I can't actually see who that is. It's Western Union, you know, and it's actually Western Union is promising that this guy's kosher. So give him what we say. Back. Is that right? Yeah, personal. So while authority was provided by the issuer of the card, like Western Union, the holder of value was now us. Our names are on it front and center. So this is a massive change in money. You know, before it had George Washington on it or the Taoiseach, and it talked about the central bank. And now actually the biggest name on it is my name. So I'm of value. This is really important. This is a kind of major shift in the mindset of money. And, you know, not surprisingly, credit cards became canvases for new types of messages. It no longer needs a story to convince us of our wealth, so it's somewhere that can be much more abstract, much more dynamic, much more flashy. You know, and while a wad of notes always spoke loudly, suddenly for those inclined, here was a loudhailer, the gold American Express card, and then the platinum American Express card. This is something you could flash and talk about how important you were. So money is kind of taken on this whole sense of image, and what it means to be the holder of this object is, again, something that's beyond even the representation that that money holds. But then as we see it evolve, the credit card and our relationship to money has changed. It's become something much more indicative of the material used to make it. Cheap, shiny, endlessly replaceable, and damaging to the planet. And moldable to our every desire. You know, credit cards started becoming customizable. You can put your favorite little puppy on it. I mean, it's so much about us at this stage. And it's very cheap. And then contactless comes along. I can now pay for things with my magic wand, which I wave in front of things. But even carrying that plastic is a pain. So actually, can you put it on my phone with everything else of value, and hopefully nobody will steal it or something like that? And ultimately, it's led me to this kind of sense that, money is becoming weightless. From this kind of point where I actually have something and you have something and we can change it, through carrying the value of something in a coin, this leap of imagination in paper money, and that this is now worth something, and then into actually plastic that you can wave at things. It's becoming something that people design so they can blog about it. It's becoming something that this is the actual Norwegian banknote that was crowdsourced from different design agencies. And they eventually picked a very pixelated one. And this kind of did the rounds on social media. So the people who are issuing the money are using it as a social currency as well, because actually it gets them a wider understanding of what they do. And like everything we want to be part of it. We want to shape it to make something personal, to turn it into data, and ultimately some sort of social currency. So I'm left wondering, is this the future of money? And I guess that hopefully sets out the stall. Thanks.
Services of the central bank. He's going to talk us through how money is produced, the role the central bank plays in that, and the security features of money, and also to take a look at how the central bank's role and cash's role evolves as we move towards a cashless society. So next up, Paul.
Thank you, Emma, good afternoon, everybody. Eleanor's working the computer upstairs, so Scott, I'm going to give this a go, and if I run similar things to yourself, I'm going to rely on Eleanor, please. So first of all, to the Science Gallery, thank you very much for the invitation to speak today. I think it's appropriate that the central bank should speak at a topic such as this, as money is at the center of the financial system, and it impacts on every consumer in the economy. And the mission of the central bank, which I've put up there, is to safeguard stability and protect consumers. And to do this, we in the central bank, and particularly the only physical product we make, we need to make sure that we are trusted by the public, and the public have trust in the currency, in the tangibility of the product that we talk about. The cash that we use in Ireland, the euro, is part of a common currency. We, in the Central Bank of Ireland, we work collaboratively with the other 18 countries in the euro system to manufacture and distribute the currency. So ensuring that we have the respect of our peers in the euro system in how we do this is extremely important to us. And finally, obviously, like every organization, central to the success of our organization is our staff. So our vision as an organization is to be trusted by the public in all that we do, respected by our peers, both here and abroad, and ensure that we have a fulfilling place for our people. And everybody needs to be able to use money, whether it be to pay in shops and all the other things that Emma even prompted us to think about at the start there. So a stable financial system depends on secure and reliable payments. And I think if we think back to some of the incidents that have happened in the more recent times, probably, if they don't mind me mentioning it, the Ulster Bank incident when their technology systems failed, and now everybody in that banking, our customers of that bank, made a flight to cash in many instances. And our role in the central bank is to ensure that payment systems, including currency, are safe, resilient, and efficient. So to talk you through this, thanks, Eleanor, I propose that we would go through the following topics. If that's okay, I'm not going to read them out. You can read them, all right? I'm going to move straight in to cash as a payment instrument. And it has some unique characteristics and features. Scott has talked through some of those. But despite the emergence of technologies, and Rachel will talk about those, right now it is proven to be the most effective technology, particularly for micropayments. It's widely used, is acceptable, and indeed has no exclusivity to it. Some of the things that Scott referred to there. Even people who don't have bank accounts or have limited access to them, they can still make payments using cash. It is for everybody. It's great technology because you actually, you know what? You almost get instant reconciliation. You know how much I have straight away. You don't have to be worrying about software or tools to work out where you stand. And as well as being a payment instrument, it is a store of value. And for the euro, a significant amount of euros are stored simply as a currency of stability. And as I referred to, when electronic systems fail, it is the one payment system that is treated as the most robust contingency. And for a long time now, people have been predicting the demise of cash. Well, the cash that we use, the euro, as you know, was introduced about 13 years ago. It is spreading with the growth of the euro system, continuing countries are coming on, Latvia and Lithuania being the more recent ones. This summer, we passed the 1 trillion mark of the value in circulation. Over 18 billion pieces of currency are in circulation. And obviously, we're familiar with the three predominant denominations, the 50, the 20, and the 10, but there are 7 in total. So the trajectory for the use of cash and the volume of cash is actually increasing. The most popular note in circulation is the 50, and you can see the values there. And since 2010, cash has been on the increase, the production of cash. And as you can see there, in terms of volume and value, it's grown by over 25%. So I do believe that we are heading to a less cash society. But I don't believe for one moment we're reaching a cashless society. And frankly, in my own lifetime, I don't think we will see a cashless society. And as Rachel comes on and talks, we'll see more of the prevalence of possible opportunities for less cash. I'm going to go on and talk a little bit now about how we ensure the security and the trust of cash. There's no one silver bullet that makes cash a secure instrument. In the euro system, we take a multifaceted approach, and I'm going to bring you through some slides of that. First of all, you saw the values and the volumes and the dispersity of the currency. It's actually a centralized currency. We have a single currency. And we centralize the standards. So in the ECB, there's a directorate of banknotes, and we all, as the national central banks, contribute to it, and we set the standards there. And we decentralize the manufacturing. Seven national central banks, or eight actually, national central banks produce the currency. In Ireland, we have a print facility, not a mint. Mint is where they get coin, by the way. A print is where we produce it. We do produce a little bit of coin. But that's only eight NCBs. So the other national central banks all procure notes on the market. On a decentralized basis, but with strong centralized standards. Paper is the main component of the cash. The Bank of England are moving towards polymer, but in the euro system, we're staying with paper. And the security features start at that very source. Paper tint is added to the pulp. UV dullness is put into the paper. It then goes through a printing process. And if my little machine works for me here, as I talk, I'll just show you some of the features to it there. There are five stages to a printing process for a note, where we put on ultraviolet, infrared, multiluminescent inks, small circle marks. We go then on to optically vertical magnetic ink printing, the spark feature, and I'll come and talk about that in a second. We layer on it then intaglio printing, where the infrared properties start to become evident on it. We then put numbers on it, for each banknote has a unique identifier. Can anybody tell me how you would recognize a banknote printed in Ireland? Pardon my colleagues from the central bank. Well, actually, every euro banknote is to look exactly the same and look and feel exactly the same, and that's the standards, bar one feature, the number on it. And to identify a banknote that's printed in Ireland, you'll see the letter T at the start of the number on the banknote. Apart from that, right across the euro systems, all banknotes look exactly the same by design. And then having put the numbering on it, for particularly the 5 and the 10 now, we put a coating on it to give them longer and greater durability. Through all stages of the manufacturing process, quality is built in to reach a stage where every note that goes into circulation is perfect. And there are many, many steps throughout the whole process to ensure what's produced at each stage reaches the quality standards. Where not, it's kicked out, and then we go on to the next one and we build it up so that each note is perfect. It's very much an industrial operation. We're embracing lean manufacturing. We want to eliminate waste to the greatest extent possible. We want to make it as efficient as possible. But the overriding factor is to ensure the quality of the banknote at all times. Other aspects of the integrated security, or the multifaceted security, are various features to the banknote to give those who use the banknote confidence that they're dealing with an authentic note. We call them level 1, level 2, and level 3 features. Each of you, as a citizen and as a user of it, I'd encourage you to think about the level 1 features. They're designed for all of us. You'll be familiar with them in terms of when you hold a note up to the light and you can see the features in it. There's an expression we use called look, feel, and tilt. And those of you, beside you is a little card which Maeve was given. See those guys there? Each one of you should have one of them on your pedestal somewhere or on your chair. If you go out into daylight and you start turning it like that and feeling the edges, you can start to begin to feel the erased feel to it. Okay? That's what we call the feel touch to it on either side. Eleanor, can you hit me the next slide, please? Yeah. See the edging of the notes there? We used to only have them on the high denomination notes, but since we started to roll out the new series of the banknotes, you can feel it on the left-hand side of the card there. I went back to the look bit, which is the previous slide, Eleanor, where you can see the holograms. And if you go on to the next slide and the following one again, when you can actually do a tilt, and there's the spark feature that I talked about earlier, you'll see it change. They're all user features, customer features, which you can look at, and if they are in the note, then at least you know you're at least at a level one, you're dealing with an authentic note. We've built in what we call level two features, and they're for professional cash handlers, banks who sort bank notes, large multiples, organizations that deal in large volumes of cash. If they want to get from us what those level two features are, we will tell them. The banknote equipment sorting manufacturers, they're giving them, they build them in. So when they're processing their notes, they're checking every one of them for the level two features. That's the next level of authenticity. And the third level is what we call level three. That's only in the central banks. We make sure on an annual basis that we get about 3 in 10 notes back. Banknote has a, as you can imagine, a life cycle. A fiver goes around 1.5 times, maybe twice. You know, a 100 euro note, for those of you who have seen them, they go around a good few times, and the 500 euro note never gets out anyway, because none of us have them. But in our equipment in the central bank, we will apply the level three security checks on every note that comes back to us, and we've designed processes in the cash cycle to ensure that we get 30% of the notes back on a regular basis, so as we can check them. So as that way, we can maintain the confidence, your confidence in the currency. So that when you go to an ATM, you know the note that you're getting out is valid. It's not going to be counterfeited. We also educate professional cash handlers. We have a team that go out and will happily work with staff in the banks and the large multiples to help them understand what the level two features are. And we also run spot checks. We have an objective to ensure we visit a certain number of towns per annum. The team arrive unannounced, and they will go through every retailer, every bank, every post office, checking all of their banknote handling equipment to make sure it has the appropriate features on it to check for the authenticity of banknotes. If it's not there, well, we have discussions with them, shall we say, and we make sure that to be a professional cash handler, they need to get accreditation from us, and that's one way that we do it. So which leads us, I suppose, into the whole area of counterfeiting. And like the poor, the counterfeiters will always be with us. There's a continuing race to ensure that we can stay ahead of them. Bank of England's decision to go with polymer was pretty much based on the level of counterfeits which they were experiencing. The euro system and the approach that we've taken, we actually have pretty good counterfeit rates. Of the 18 billion notes that are in circulation, we've picked up about 500,000 of counterfeits. So just put that in context. 18 billion notes and 500,000 are picked up. You can see we in the central bank have what we call the National Analysis Center. So as the Gardaí or as retailers pick up frauds, they're back to us. We classify them, we share them with the other euro systems. Our colleagues in the Bank of Italia probably have the biggest challenge with regard to fraud and counterfeit. You'll be aware of the new series of euro banknotes. The fiver, I'll talk about it in a minute, but the fiver went out 2 years ago. We're seeing a little bit of a testing of the waters on fivers, particularly in the Mediterranean states, where we think some people are experimenting to see, well, if they can get a fiver out and they can prove that they can get that going well, then they'll be able to build up to the higher denoms. We get great cooperation from the public and obviously from the enforcement authorities to ensure the counterfeits are identified. We've built in protections. We work a lot with the technology companies. We have a team in the euro system that spend their whole life making sure that printers, i.e. all the printers that we have on our desks or the MFD devices that we have in the workplace, that they will not photocopy banknotes. So if you ever try and photocopy a banknote, actually it won't work. We've worked to ensure that as the Canons and the Dells of this world, as they all produce their printers, they sign up to an accreditation, and it prevents banknotes being photocopied, which is a pretty basic element, you might say. the new series of banknotes, the ES2 as we call it, the second series of the euro system. I talked about the fiver there a few minutes ago and the tenner, which came out last year. The 20 comes out on the 25th of November. Our investment is all about the detection and the deterrence for counterfeiting. And we're certainly pleased with what we've identified so far. There's a continuing investment in the standards, as well as enhanced security features. We're always looking for efficiency to try and reduce the cost. So there's durability, as I mentioned, added into the notes there. The note that will come out soonest is the 20 on the 25th of November. Gotcha. This card in particular that you have is focused in on it, in that there is some innovative technologies for the prevention of fraud, which I won't go into in great detail, but essentially on the right-hand side of the note, as you look at it, there'll be a strip, metallic strip typically. Well, actually, as you tilt that strip, you'll be able to see features of the note within it. And again, very, very difficult to recreate that without sort of the investment that the euro system puts into our banknote printing operations. To bring us to the end of the cycle, what happens when banknotes become unsuitable? You can imagine the fivers, how quickly they're turned around. Basically, that's why we take all the banknotes back. As well as checking for their authenticity, we want to check for their durability and that they're suitable for use. We're quite proud of the quality of banknotes. We want to make sure that they're suitable for use all the time and that people get the confidence in them. So we destroy those notes that we consider not being suitable. It's quite a mechanistic. There's a large industrial plant involved in it. And basically, they go down a chute and they get shredded. And ultimately they end up in one of these Weetabix boxes like this, or these briquettes. Emma was saying, based on an algorithm about the notes in currency, or the currency in circulation, if we look at the distribution of them, i.e. there's a lot more 20s and 50s in circulation, and the rate that we destroy them at, on average, as Rachel said, there's about 26 grand in each one of those. They're very good door stoppers. And if anybody can think of a really good, suitable, green type of use for these, I'd love to hear. I think it's a shocking shame that we have to do this and they become this, but surely there must be a way of recycling them or contributing to the agenda some way. Maeve is with me here, okay? So we didn't think there were going to be this many people. I was hoping to be able to say, you know, there's one for everybody in the audience. But there's less of these than there are of you. So Maeve McLaughlin in the corner there can work out some way of distributing them. But certainly if somebody has a good idea, I'd be delighted to hear it. And if anybody wants to open one, all right, and think that they can put the banknotes back together again, good luck to you. Just don't open it when I'm around, okay? Because they're very compressed, okay? And when they open, well, you know, you need to have a Hoover near you, okay? That's all I would say to you. Two final shots if I've not run out of time. On the 28th of October, the Central Bank will introduce the voluntary rounding, hopefully leading to a significant, massively significant reduction in the proliferation of 1 and 2 cent coin. That's part of the National Payments Plan. And the National Payments Plan is all about making sure that the right people have the right payment instruments at the right cost or price, whatever it might be. The Minister's introduction of a transfer of the levy that he did have on the ATM card, he simply transferred that to transactions. So there's no change in the tax level. All it's trying to do is influence behavior. Cash is a really good technology. It has its place in society. It has a very secure mechanism of payment, and it's the right thing to use for the right transactions. But if you're buying a car or something, you know, over 10 grand's worth, don't pay it in cash. It's just not designed for that. And that's what the National Payments Plan is all about. It's trying to get people to use the right payment instruments in the right place and making sure that the cost and the price of them is there. And the central bank is looking to drive as much efficiency into the cash cycle as we can. There's lots more I could say, but I will hold it there. Thank you for your attention. And I'm going to pass back to our chair. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Paul. I hope everyone has lots of ideas for how to use the 26 grand now. We've spoken a lot so far about trust and fraud and how those features interact within money, and how money's design and evolution and production and regulation of it has changed to reflect those features. Next up is Rachel. Dr. Rachel O'Dwyer is a research fellow in the School of Computer Science and Statistics here in Trinity. Her research has a particular focus on virtual payments and mobile networks, and she's going to talk to us tonight a little about digital currencies, virtual payments, Bitcoin, and the traceability of these methods versus the anonymity of cash. So next up, Rachel.
So we've heard a lot already about this idea of a cashless society, and are we entering a cashless society? And if so, what are the implications then of virtual payments for the future of privacy and the future of security? I think we can argue that money is both a token and a rail, or both information and infrastructure. So you have information about payments and pricing on one hand, but then you have the rails that support and secure money, even as Paul is talking about. So historically, those rails were things like the central bank, and obviously even people, so people supporting the flow and circulation of money. Increasingly, what we're seeing is the rails of the infrastructures that support money are information and communication technologies, and that has real implications then for the relationship between money and data and then privacy going forward. So we've heard a bit already about this idea of a cashless society, and are we moving towards, you know, a society maybe that has less cash? But I think we've already seen, both from Scott and Paul's presentations, that there's quite a lot still to recommend cash, and that there's also a particular kind of materiality to cash that we don't get with virtual payments. So, you know, we can see that there's cash is often used for gifts. So this is a money dance, which is kind of a tradition in Greek weddings. I was thinking of an Irish tradition that we're probably all familiar with. So, you know, somebody's so cheap, they still have their confirmation money. So these are little money boxes. So they're kind of a material culture around cash as a gift in Irish society. So even though, I mean, cash and currency is supposed to be fungible, it's supposed to be exchangeable, that there are maybe these kind of material and quite personal and social traces around the exchange of money. So money also, I was kind of heard a talk recently by an anthropologist of money, Bill Maurer, who's really, really interesting. And he was talking a little bit about earmarking with money, so practices that people have of maybe you set aside money that you've been given as a gift, or you might have set aside money for charity or earmark particular kinds of cash. So we're seeing that there are these practices. And then also that obviously money is, cash has an anonymity to it as well. So this is quite a significant advantage today when we're seeing that a lot of virtual transactions are increasingly being indexed and tracked. So if I exchange money with you, that there's not that same kind of paper trail of what I purchased or what I did with it or where it's traveling. And that's obviously why as well cash supports sometimes illegal economies, but also that, you know, it supports these informal economies. And as Paul was saying, that it's a very, very inclusive currency. So there's a lot to actually recommend cash. This is a quote from Peter Sunday of the Pirate Bay. So if everything is traceable, I can't read that from the back. So if everything is traceable, you start thinking about your purchasing behavior. So you need cash maybe to support some kinds of anonymous behavior. So maybe we still need cash to actually remain outside of scrutiny. So cash is anonymous most of the time. But if we actually look closer, we can see that cash also leaves traces. And again, Paul's talk, I think, has touched on that there are ways of maybe tracking bills. So you've probably all heard of marked bills. This is kind of an interesting one. You might have seen it on social media in March, so following the death of the actor who played Dr. Spock, there are these Canadian $5 bills where people were marking those up in his honor, so turning the Prime Minister, seventh Prime Minister, I think, into Dr. Spock. This one was, I don't know if anyone's come across this, is in circulation in Ireland, actually. So it's a political statement about direct provision that's being kind of inserted as a secret kind of message. So it's kind of another layer of information or another kind of token that's being added to this. But obviously the most obvious kind of marked bills then are actually the way that, you know, all cash has a serial number. So we learned about the fact that euros now, if you want to see whether they're from Ireland, that there's a particular, you know, peculiarity to the serial number that tells you that. So this means that cash actually can be traced. And it's led to things like currency tracking sites such as Where's George, which is quite similar to book crossing, if anyone's come across book crossing, where you can register a secondhand book and then sort of put that out into the world and see where it's traveling. You can also register a dollar bill. As far as I know, it's just for dollars, so it's just in the States. And you add, I think, information about the serial number, which is ringed up there, and the denomination, the date that you put into circulation, and then your zip codes, where you are. And you spend that into circulation, and hopefully people will maybe come across the little marker on the bill and register that. So there's actually thousands of dollar bills that have been tracked through Where's George. And what was interesting then about this data is that actually by looking at where money was flowing and where money was circulating, that people were able to find out information about maybe the behavior of epidemics or diseases and how things passed through kind of mobility or circulation. This is a project by, he's a theoretical physicist actually called Dirk Brockman, where he used data from Where's George to redraw state lines. So by looking at actually how money was circulating within different states, he found that there was actually borders that were slightly different to the actual borders of the state in terms of how far money tended to circulate and where it tended to go. He also published an article in Nature looking at this idea of epidemics. And it's quite similar to projects that have been done with cell phone data as well. What we see with the data of payments is that, or the data of cash in that sense, is that there's still a limit about how much you can tell with a marked bill. So you can't tell what it's being spent on or who it's being passed to necessarily. You can just see where it's kind of circulating in space or in time. And obviously there's also really, really powerful opt-in in terms of these kinds of currency tracking sites. So you have to actually physically register the bill. What we're seeing today though is this money's increasingly riding the rails of information and communication technologies. So, you know, things like Venmo in the States or Apple Pay, Snap Cash, even Twitter is developing tweets for cash. We're finding that our money's increasingly then riding the rails of information and communication technologies. And that means then that information about money can be gathered together with information about your identities, about your purchases, and about where you are, about your affiliations and your networks. So kind of a whole range of different information can be brought together. And what we're seeing then is that today, the value often in these money transfers is in that information. So it's less about actually transaction fees, which is what you had in the case with things like Western Union historically, which interestingly enough actually was a telegraph company. It's less about then you paying a transaction fee and more about you paying with your personal data. So, you know, as society goes cashless, companies have a larger and a more profitable business in basically selling your data to third-party advertisers. And that's the value proposition that we're seeing in a lot of mobile payments, is more around this data rather than actually you paying to move money from A to B. We might ask, so what? Like, why is this significant? Because we've seen that there's a lot of value to cash, but there's also drawbacks to cash. So if I lose cash, it's gone, whereas if something happens often on my credit card, I have some kind of a recourse usually. So there's more security sometimes around virtual payments, and there's obviously a huge amount of convenience. So I was at a wedding on Friday, and we wanted to leave a couple of bottle of wines for somebody who let us stay in their house, and there was a huge negotiation about how we were all going to basically put money in somebody's account. But even that's, you know, much, much more convenient with different kinds of technologies like PayPal. So it can be very, very convenient in a lot of ways. But then there's also consequences in terms of increased profiling or control and increased surveillance around virtual payments. So this Amazon example is quite a good one. So they patented a technology called anticipatory logistics in January of 2015. So the idea is basically using market basket analysis, using kind of the history of your payments to predict what you're likely to purchase in the future and logistically move that stuff closer to you. Not necessarily like dropping it on your doorstep with the drone, but you know, moving it closer to you. So it's a predictive kind of shipping. You might have heard of this. It's almost a urban legend at this stage, although it's a true story, where a Target, who are like a big chain store in the States, were able to identify that a teenage girl was pregnant before her parents knew about it. So based on the kinds of products that she'd been purchasing basically in Target, then she was sort of algorithmically profiled as possibly being a pregnant woman and got information, you know, about discounts off cribs and so on. So, I mean, there's implications there, though, beyond maybe being pushed unwanted recommendations or having to see advertisements maybe that you don't want to see, and that this information can also be used to, you know, in a kind of governmental sense, it can be used to kind of produce new kinds of state surveillance, profiling, or discrimination. And we're already seeing elements of that in terms of a lot of virtual payments data is quite significant now in terms of calculating your credit scorings. But also, this is, for example, a system, I suppose, that's being used in Italy to use virtual payments data to identify tax fraud. And you can imagine situations maybe where that information is also used in cases of maybe personal insolvency or bankruptcy or so on. So what we're finding is that even though corporations that handle virtual payments, there's an inequality in terms of questions of transparency on the one hand and then secrecy on the other. So even the corporations that handle virtual payments know an awful lot about us, often very, very fine-tuned detail. So there's a book by guy Frank Pascal who argues that this profiling data is as fine-tuned today as like possibly has a daughter who died in a car crash, gullible elderly. So it's not just like 18 to 24-year-old males. It's very, very fine-tuned. So while these companies, anyway, know a lot about us, the details of these algorithms that are profiling and making decisions tend to be black-boxed, and they're not very easy to understand or to gain access because often they're trade secrets, so you're not actually allowed to know how they work. So there's an imbalance there. So kind of finish up, I wanted to talk very quickly about cryptocurrencies. So some people have looked to cryptocurrencies then as a possible alternative. So as a way of producing anonymous payments online or virtual payments that maybe have less of a data trace. So cryptocurrencies are digital payments that are using encryption technologies to verify transactions, to verify the transfer of funds, as opposed to the central bank, for example, in the case of a denominated currency like the euro. And Bitcoin has basically, which is kind of the best known cryptocurrency, has a level of anonymity in it. Because basically when you're doing transactions, you use public keys and you use private keys, which suppose we could think of public keys maybe as being a bit like your bank account address, while a private key is a bit like your personal PIN. So you don't disclose the private key to anybody, but you disclose the public key when you're making a transaction. But unlike a bank account, that public key isn't associated with your name in the same kind of way. And also, you can generate many different public keys. So not just, there isn't just one associated with you, there might be many. And this allows then for a certain amount of anonymity, which is why I suppose there was anxieties earlier on in Bitcoin in terms of it being used maybe to purchase contraband goods on Silk Road or to buy drugs or being used in crime. So in terms of there was anxiety, I guess, from kind of an anti-money laundering perspective as well around Bitcoin. But technically, like Bitcoin is actually, it's a pseudo-anonymous currency. So it's not actually completely anonymous because once basically that public key is revealed in some way, then your identity can also be revealed. So that anonymity is actually quite precarious. And secondly, in some ways it's actually very transparent or a public kind of technology, because all transactions are publicly stored on a shared ledger, and that ledger is publicly available basically to anybody who's participating. So unlike cash or, you know, even some other kinds of virtual payments, it's possible to actually trace the whole history of any given payment, even years after the fact. So there's, in some ways, there's a greater level of transparency with the Bitcoin ledger. So it's very, very public. And so people develop techniques then for identifying Bitcoins, or sorry, identifying Bitcoin addresses. So by basically trawling through social media sites or forums and finding public keys and associating them with particular identities, and then using different kinds of, even the sorts of analysis actually that social media analytics use to cluster together people in different groups. So if you had a transaction in a particular group, that then it's possible to also start revealing the identities of other people who are transacting in the network, and by degrees then basically making associating those public keys with particular individuals, and then even adding in other information. So, you know, computers have unique MAC addresses, so they have hardware addresses that associate them with a particular machine, and then IP addresses. So then you could even locate those transactions in particular places. So I suppose the implications of that then are that, you know, Bitcoin is anything but anonymous today. So that has, you know, huge implications for anti-money laundering, but also for fungibility. So what we're seeing is not all Bitcoins are equal as well, that there's very, very different histories. So there's been some attempts then to create even more anonymous kinds of cryptocurrencies then through what's called Bitcoin laundering. So basically using just different techniques to try and obfuscate that path or to hide your tracks when you're using Bitcoin. So maybe mixing your coins with the coins of other people in different ways, or swapping coins between users, or having a sort of a shared kind of pool or a wallet where you're kind of working with a group of other people, and when you want to make a payment, you sort of pick a random transaction. Zero coin then is a fork of Bitcoin that's trying to develop this idea of direct anonymous payments between parties. And it's basically just using post techniques to try and disassociate inputs from outputs in those transactions, and basically just finding ways of trying to make cryptocurrencies more anonymous. But post this question of then virtual payments and tracking, and then using maybe cryptocurrencies as a way to develop anonymous payments, throws up some questions. So I suppose the first one around the shift maybe from cashless to virtual payments is, what are the material cultures, or what cultures may be lost or being created in the shift from cash to virtual payments? We saw that there's quite interesting practices and materialities to cash. And can we say the same maybe for virtual currencies, or for currencies like Bitcoin? What are those social practices that we're going to see maybe come into play? Then obviously there's a question of power, like who gets to maintain secrecy, and who has to be, you know, who's charged with being transparent in transactivity? And do we have a right maybe to keep financial transactions secret, or is there an argument that for maybe anti-money laundering or crime reasons that we should maybe be transparent? Yeah, I'll finish up there. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Rachel. I'm aware that we're a little over time here, so we'll keep the panel discussion and the Q&A pretty brief. But maybe just one thing, just as a quick question to everyone before we open to the floor. We've spoken a lot about how money's changed, but as Rachel touched on at the end, that obviously gives way to behavioural changes. The thing I'd be interested to hear from all of you is, how quickly do you think people are catching up with the evolution of money? one thing that struck me is a piece I read in the paper about 2 years ago about a lady who ran a B&B in Offaly. And at the time, Bitcoin was a big phenomenon. We were doing lots and lots of coverage about it. And this lady ran a B&B in Offaly, had done for years. Her son happened to be a computer scientist. And he had said, "Ma'am, there's this thing called Bitcoin," of which she had no idea what it was. But she said, "Well, sure, people can pay with that. That's fine." Not knowing how that worked or how it happened. But it was just an interesting insight into how people's behavior changes. So maybe just to throw it to you first, Scott, do you think, you spoke about it, how money has changed. Do you think behavior has caught up?
I think for me, the major change happened with the kind of internet digital revolution, whatever this phase that we're entering is going to be called, is that the change in behavior is actually leading a lot of the changes as opposed to the other way around. You know, and a 10-year-old kid playing their Xbox and getting pushed 2 euro tokens by their mom and kind of like having this online banking system, you know, when that kid reaches 25, his sense of money and his behavior around money will be so completely different to anything that's happening. And if you take that, I mean, it's one of those things that, you know, I think if you look at like the major change that's really happened through the kind of lens of the internet is, you know, there were all these bunkers before, finance, you know, medicine, science, all these things, and actually the walls around them have all kind of been pulled apart and they're all kind of overlapping now. And I think if you take everything that's happening together, you know, I think when we've seen anything else being disrupted in the last kind of 5-10 years, it happens really quickly, you know. And I don't know if that answers your question, but I actually think that the changes will happen quickly when they start to happen, and actually people's behaviors are already ahead of the curve. You know, I think that people are ready for something different in general.
And maybe on that pace of evolution, is that something that poses a particular challenge to regulators, Paul?
Yeah, and thank you, because I did want to say in relation to Bitcoin, it'd be remiss of me as a staff member of the central bank not to comment on the regulatory environment around Bitcoin. Bitcoin is an unregulated currency. So for all of us, in terms of the normal payment instruments that we use, there's a regulated environment and we can take confidence and comfort from that. I'm not sure if you're aware, there's a thing called the Deposit Guarantee Scheme. So any money that you have in the bank is guaranteed up to 100 grand. Bitcoin isn't covered by, for example, the DGS. You know, I got to put a really strong health warning on Bitcoin. I think with regard to the evolution and the future, I think Scott's right. I think there is a need, there will be a leap. People have been talking about, the move to a cashless society, whereas the evidence is the exact opposite. I think the mobile technology is the game changer. The features that I talk about, cash, it's ease of use, it's ubiquitousness, simple things like an ease of reconciliation, all that. Do you know what? The contactless cards and all of the traditional devices just don't do it. But I think there's something in the mobile and in mobile payments that's going to change the game.
I'm bringing Rachel.
I think it's kind of interesting in terms of the cashless society, because it's emerging markets in the global south that are actually driving its idea of the cashless society. Mm-hmm. So we might say, is there anything in mobile payments or cashless, kind of contactless payments, are they really going to be taken up here or become kind of, are they going to replace cash? But actually, you know, in a lot of parts of the global south where people are unbanked, where they don't have access to financial services, or even where actually currencies can be quite insecure, there's been a huge amount of take up of mobile payments, because actually most people have access to mobile phones today, but a lot of people don't have access to bank accounts. So there's a lot of informal practices actually around sending money over mobile phones just in the form of text messages.
That brings us back to something that Paul raised earlier, the idea that we'll move towards less cash but not cashless. I suppose just before we throw it open to questions, I'm going to ask you all, put you all on the spot and ask you one last question. Don't look so scared. I'm just going to ask you, 50 years from now, will we still be using cash, yes or no? So start with Scott and we'll bang our way through the panel.
I don't think so, no.
Paul?
Yes, and I support that with a simple statement. Probably the most advanced economies in our sphere are the Nordic countries. Sweden next year launches a new currency. It's investing in currency. It's still used. I think there'll be a reduction in the use,
but
I think cash
away.
will be here.
And Rachel?
Yeah, but I think maybe it might not look like what we expected to. So we saw actually, you know, with Scott's talk that cash and the materiality of cash has taken lots of different forms. So it might be, you know, something completely unexpected.
But we'll still have it in some form.
Yeah, I guess so.
I know we're a bit behind here, guys, but has anyone got a question? We've got a couple of roving mics, so if you have a question, raise your hand. Okay, first lady up was right behind the clock there.
Hi, this is a question for Paul, mostly. Just relating back to the last question that you talked about there, the future of being a cashless society. Back around November, under the Freedom of Information Act in the UK, it emerged that the Bank of England are looking at creating a state-backed digital currency, a state-backed crypto-based currency in the UK. And I think with the information that was released that they're targeting, you know, in the next 10 to 15 years to have 50% of their the cash in the money in circulation would be digitally represented with their own crypto digital currency version of the pound. How do you think the Irish government would take, what kind of a position do you think you would take on that, insofar as it being, you know, how ethical do you think it is to control your citizens' spending via a state-backed digital currency?
I suppose the manner in which even the question is phrased, in terms of you bring in ethics into it, I'm not so sure it's a question for the Irish government. We're part of a single euro, a single currency area, the euro, and the currency is produced by the European Central Bank as per what I talked about there in terms of the standards. It's governed by the Governing Council, which each national central bank is on, including the Irish Central Bank. So just central banking and government, there is a segregation of duties there. I have no knowledge of Ireland contributing at euro system level to any cryptocurrencies. And as regards the ethics of it, well, to be honest, I would leave that to more profound persons who would understand those things better than I do, if you don't mind.
There was a couple of other hands just down here in the front. We have two questions, Colin. Oh, actually three, but you can pick.
You discussed cashless currency tonight primarily in terms of behavioral trends, and I was wondering if anyone in Ireland or even in the ECB is seriously looking at the effect on maybe government revenue or market behavior if we just eliminated cash.
Any takers?
I mean, it's not something I can answer, but I would imagine, I mean, the thing for me is we're framing this as a conversation about money. And for me, it's a kind of more fundamental question than that. When you look, when you take everything that's going on with, you know, the what's happening in Greece, what's happening in Spain, what happened in Ireland, people's relationship to the very idea of money, the fact that, you know, there's this kind of greater divide between rich and poor, and actually there's a massive dissatisfaction. All these things change our kind of understanding of what money is and what it means. And if you take that alongside what's happening with technology, for me, the question is actually less about will money still be around and more about, you know, what will value mean in 50 years' time. And I think that's, what was the question again?
The effect on governments.
I was just wondering, instead of thinking about it as our own behavior, would it become a cashless economy because we stop using cash? Have we thought about it as what if we eliminated cash? How would that impact markets and how would that impact government revenue? I was just wondering, is that an angle you've considered?
Anyone else?
The elimination of cash assumes a replacement in terms of back to from the very basics that Scott was talking about as a bartering, as a transfer of value. So I think since man was around, we need a system for a transfer of value. We have many methods to do that, one of which is cash.
I see we're kind of on the wire on time, so maybe one quick last question. Anyone on this side want to get involved? I know there's a couple. That guy there in the middle.
Thanks. There wasn't much talk here about complementary currencies, but they obviously have an interesting role to play. And I wondered, isn't this all fantastically naive if there can't be any innovation without the ECB or without the central bank? I mean, I guess my question would be, what are the legal protocols for a complementary currency or something like that, or a currency innovation that you speak of, to be able to pay local rates or something like that? Do you know what I mean? Because if a currency can't pay taxes, it's not a currency. Does anybody want to take that up?
So you're talking about something like the Brixton pound or something?
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. And again, I think that the thing I was saying there before is, I think that's a really interesting area, and it's going to be a burgeoning area. I think that the main change that technology has facilitated is a change from... it's the power is now in the user's hands, and people feel empowered. Now, it's not to say that there isn't regulation or isn't, like, you know, I think security and kind of, and whoever's going to define that transaction, that's where the interesting kind of thing will happen. But I think we're going to see a lot more of that in years to come, because ultimately I think that as people get disillusioned with money and payment and their place in the world, that actually there will be a kind of lots of opportunity for complementary currencies, cryptocurrencies, things to crop up. Now, most of them will be prototypes and fall by the wayside, but I think ultimately this is the kind of framework, and this will be the kind of explorative stage of what the next, the next part of evolution of money or value or how we transact as humans is going to be transfer of value ultimately comes down to.
It's great to think though that like you can have it, there's maybe a plurality, like maybe it's not just one denominated currency and there's different many kinds of money that we use, like you say, the right kind of money, different kinds of money for different kinds of transactions. The problem with the complementary currencies, as I think Ed was saying, is that like there's no... it's very, very difficult to scale a complementary currency to get it to a position where you're paying taxes or where it can move beyond kind of a small network of like people who trust each other. I think that's a real, problem.
Just to add to that, for them to evolve, there's things like exchange rates, transfer mechanisms. There's a whole ecosystem that goes with payments. Cash is only one form of payment. In fact, it's probably not the most predominant form of payment. If you look at the electronic transfers and the values that are going through them and the networks and the support and the controls around them. So for something alternative to actually be a game changer, it's got to have considerable scale behind it.
I think we leave it there. Just want to thank our panel, to Scott Burnett, Paul Molumby and Dr. Rachel Dwyer. A round of applause.
Thank you.
Also, thank you to the team at the Science Gallery, Emma, Eleanor, Colin, who've been running around with the mics and so on. Thanks to them. And to anyone who hasn't checked out the exhibition, I'd highly recommend it. Thanks for your patience and your time, and go out and spend wisely now.
'Think I could take a money bill to somebody. I'm actually going tomorrow. I'm going to the States tomorrow to Money 2020. Yeah. Las Vegas.